let's move on a little further in our understanding of keeping the neck free. Maybe I shouldn't even say keeping, it implies a position. So even though we appear to be very still, we should always have a sense of lengthening or intention so that we have a feeling of openness in our body and in our spine. So again, this is difficult for people to understand if they're trying to achieve everything muscularly, being in a position, trying to stand up straight, trying to make the neck straight and so on. So it can be a difficult way in our mind to get to how can it be so easy, because it's a thought process, it's an understanding. If you go back to my video on the ribcage anchor, which I used the chair there as well because it gives me a good reference point, then we can be in a fairly erect but relaxed state in the chair. When we're finding that ribcage anchor, which is a method of finding a way to keep our back back or to keep our axis back and to keep our ribcage from opening and tilting, getting that feeling almost that my spine is sliding up in the chair, and then allowing that conversational position in the head or that little nodding feeling, my head can go into a nice alignment and move up off of my spine. The other thing is an internal sense, and this is where we can learn a lot from singers. We often talk about the sound coming out of the top of our head, or the sound coming out of the crown. We're moving the sound up higher. So this is a very internal sensation. It's again not something you can feel muscularly. I like very much what my vocal coach says. For me, this works beautifully. This is also a wonderful way to find a beautiful facial expression when you're dancing. As everyone knows what a nervous look it is for someone to just put on a plastic smile or to be told, now smile. But inside, the person is so tense that it's a fake smile. So a feeling of serenity is just as fine as a smile, but it's coming from an opening in the skull and in the neck that is free. And my vocal coach says to imagine that you're smelling the bread in the oven. And if you do that, or if you don't like the smell of bread, cookies or lilacs, but if you imagine that, you'll have a natural smile, and that natural smile is because the spaces in the head are opening, right, in the nostrils and in the soft palate in the mouth and in the back of the head. I have this sense of a balloon in my head or a balloon inside the mouth. The jaw should be relaxed. So all these things, as a singer, we're thinking of our body as an instrument. How does it sound? And of course, how does that look as well? Because if all that's free, we'll have a nice facial expression. It's the same in dancing, but so often in dancing, we're concerned how we look. So we're putting a lot of extra tension, and then we can't move properly. And of course, the face always reflects that. I can feel it with my students when they start to squeeze me, or if I'm dancing with the ladies and they start to grab hold of me. That tension, whether it's in your little finger or in your jaw and your neck, will go through the whole body. So just that thought of smelling something wonderful will give you a nice natural feeling of a smile that goes up into your eyes. You feel that openness. You feel the jaw is relaxed. You find that rib cage anchor. And now I'm also using the chair here to contract my pelvic floor muscles, which I can do without putting any extra tension into my upper body, and sending my feet into the floor. So, of course, when I stand up, I would want to have that same sensation. So lifting the pelvic floor muscles and allowing that internal smile or that smelling of the fresh bread gives me this lifted sensation. So I'm using the word sensation again because many times you don't feel it, because we associate feeling with too much muscular tension. So I will address a little bit of the ladies' poise. This definitely is something you need to have a good teacher work with you. But again, understanding it, that what we're not doing is that we're not putting the chin up and dropping the skull down into those areas of the spine where all the nerves are. We want the neck to be long in the front and in the back and not shorter in the back. So when we're moving into the ladies' position, now this would be competitive, obviously not social dancing. I'll just flip this up so you can see my neck. When we move into our spiral, we rotate our head to the left. There will be times that our head will go more to the left and less. We want that freedom and not to be set. Also, if we're dancing into a promenade position, we want to be able to move the head and the neck into its full range of movement. At no time am I pinching the back of my neck. So I'm getting that intrinsic feeling of all the muscles and all the structure in my spine and in my core are part of the support of the head and of the neck. But that the rotation of the head starts at the very, very top. And the inclination then, the curve through our spine, is what is giving us that nice curve. Now there is a very slight, I'll just take this into more of a tango position here for the moment. We're just turning the head again right at the rotational joint at the top. So we're not doing something like this where you can give yourself a spasm. So now I'm going to articulate a little bit more through the upper spine. And at the very top joint at the ears, I will slightly incline. Now that's very, very small. Now you see I'm crunching my neck. So this is too much and it's too much tension. In my spiral video, we talked about intentional movement. Where are you going? So I'm never in a position, although it may look like a position. Always going somewhere. So although the head appears to arrive in its final position, as it does so, there's a lengthening. There's a sense of energy towards my partner, and a sense of energy also away from my partner, that balloon in my head, and that long neckline. Again, conversational position, rotation, curve, and slight inclination at the very top. Now, if I stand up out of the chair, there are compensations that we have to make for the lady dancer because her head needs to always be over her feet. So no matter how big of a shape she might like to make, she must not put her head behind her feet. So there's a compensation that will happen in my ankles. And when there's a compensation through the ankles, then the knees and the hips, everything else will compensate. I'm never going to tuck the pelvis and then try to put my head back. And many times this happens to ladies who are starting too early to try to achieve the position that they see on advanced dancers. They end up tucking their hips, which collapses this area. The head naturally wants to go forward, so then they force it back and then tilt the chin. So now you have a disaster going on. Very heavy for the partner and the entire body will be very tense. So as I'm moving my head back in space or up and back in space, I'm moving other parts of my body forward. So my head will still be balanced over the feet. You can see that I have not got broken neck or broken neck to the side. So this is a big subject, and every dance movement that we have, there will be some kind of intention through the head and through the spine, whether for man or for lady, in the direction of travel. So although it may look like a position, there's an activity going on through the spine. But that's going to be for another more in-depth video.